In the pre-dawn hours of May 28, 1934, in a small farmhouse in northern Ontario, a woman named Alzire Dion is in a life and death struggle. She is giving birth almost 2 months ahead of schedule, and she's having more than one child. Two midwives and a doctor work feverishly to keep mother and newborns alive. Eventually, they win the struggle, and when dawn comes, Alzire and her husband Oliva find themselves the parents of five new baby girls. Their birth will be called a modern miracle, but their lives will be modern tragedies.
Northern Ontario was a grim place in May 1934. The Depression had a firm grip on the area. Jobs were scarce, and they didn't pay very much.
There wasn't much money. I mean, we didn't have any money or anything, so we had to make our fun the best way we could, like scraping a rink out on the lake, or maybe playing ball out at the town site out here.
The birth of the five girls took place in the crudest of conditions, and the attending physician, Dr. Alan Roy Defoe, had used all of his resources to keep them alive.
He helped to keep them alive. He was a simple country doctor with simple country methods. And we had here an unusual situation, these children born premature, five of them. The fact that they were quintuplets was not really all that relevant in the first week or so, because who knew whether there was quintuplets or not? I mean, this wasn't a situation where you had the doctor come in and says, here we have the first surviving quintuplets in history, and they are going to have to be taken care of, and they're special.
The following morning, Defoe told the story of the miraculous birth to the people in Callander. Legend has it that he told the postmaster that he'd just seen five tiny French frogs. The story spread like wildfire.
There's a couple things there. First of all, very different society. The fact that they were French background, also Catholic, had a lot of bearing. Things today that, you know, really don't raise an eyebrow. But also, it's well documented that Dr. Defoe was not well known for being tactful.
Alan Roy Defoe had little use for tact. In his world, he didn't really need it. He was one of the most important men in this community. He had an education, he had seen a little bit of the world, and his talent as a doctor could mean life or death for many of the people here.
The one thing that stands out in my mind was what my whole family respected him. My mother said he was the best doctor in the world, and my father, too, said that he was the best doctor. If you deliver seven children, I guess a woman's going to think you're pretty good, like in those days, see? There wasn't any hospital to rush to or anything. We were all born at home. Well, he saved my life. When I was 6 years old, I developed a stone in my bladder, and Dr. Defoe operated on me. It took him 4 days.
Defoe had come to the north after an unhappy childhood. He was the son of an ambitious doctor from southern Ontario, and he had run away from the expectations of his family.
Well, Defoe was basically a person who didn't really strive to achieve very much in his life and didn't want anyone forcing him to achieve. He didn't really get along with his father, left Médoc, basically ran away, and he wanted to get away from any expectations on him except to be a simple person doing a simple thing and being a simple country doctor.
But even the most important person in town has to have some sense of tact, and Defoe's lack of it created some problems in the Dion household.
Today, and more than likely, a doctor going in would say to the parents, okay, we're doing this and this is the reason why. Whereas when Dr. Defoe came in, the father was kicked out of his own home, more or less, and the other children were pushed away, and it created animosity right from the start.
In the 60 years since the birth of the Quints, much has been made of the fact that Defoe did not speak French, and the story of the five tiny French frogs has not helped his reputation. but there are those in the French community who say that has been blown out of proportion.
I know he was our family doctor too, and he'd come to the house to deliver the babies and all that, and he made himself understood by to patients that couldn't understand English. But I think a lot of that was brought on by publicity.
Things get transcribed in the process of conversation. Maybe that was the language of the times as well, I don't know.
In May 1934, Oliver Dion had much bigger things to worry about than his deteriorating relationship with Dr. Defoe. He had to figure out how he was going to care for his family.
Imagine being a farmer. This is late spring, you've got five kids. Suddenly you've got five more, your family's doubled to 10. Mrs. Dion was bedridden. She would be bedridden for almost 2 months.
Well, I think you've got to look back in those years. They were a poor family, but everybody was poor. That was right in the middle of the Depression.
There were no social services at that time to help the family out, and what assistance they had received, they had no idea who was paying for it.
Meanwhile, the public curiosity which had begun in the village of Callander had spread across North America. The North Bay Nugget had told the world about the birth of what would soon be known as the Dion Quintuplets.
People couldn't support their own children. They had a hard time feeding their own children, and here were these five beautiful little children that everyone could just tap into and look at as their own children, almost like surrogate children, symbolic children.
A Chicago promoter realized he could make money from the miracle, so he offered Oliva a substantial sum if Oliva would let him display the quints at the Chicago World's Fair. Oliva signed the deal.
The contract itself was not as bad as what was later printed in headlines. In fact, the girls were not to be moved unless it was okayed by their attending physician, who was Dr. Defoe, and it was for a span of about 2 or 3 weeks, I believe. They would have been in like a small house with a glassed-in porch, and people could file by and see the girls. There would be no contact. If anyone stopped and put themselves in that situation, did the parents really want to do that, or was that the only thing that they felt they could do to support their family? Because their first concern was, how are we going to support all our children?
The public was outraged, and Dr. Defoe was among the most outspoken. The contract was never carried out.
Certainly the Chicago contract was the turning point. I think people did tend to have empathy for the family up until that point. I really think the coverage of that was taken without any regard, you know, to the actual circumstances. What's ironic is within a matter of less than a year, that was the situation anyway, that they were placed on public display.
And there is one final irony. When Oliver Dion was considering the deal, he spoke to the two most influential people in town, the parish priest and his doctor, Alan Roy Defoe. At the time, Defoe didn't believe the quints would live, and he advised Oliver to get as much out of them as he could.
When the media caught wind of it, it sounded awful. It brought it into very practical terms. These children that were fighting for their life were going to be put on display. That's when the doctor distanced himself from it. And that was a serious point. That's a very important point in this whole story. But it's totally in his character.
In a good story, of course, you've got to have the good guy and the bad guy, and the father was cast in that role, so it didn't matter what he did. That was the role that he was given, and it would be portrayed that way.
The so-called bad guy was a 31-year-old French-Canadian farmer named Oliver Dion. In the years to come, he would be portrayed as an uneducated peasant, but the reality was much different.
They were one of the families which were not on welfare. And I think it's a little unfair how they were portrayed as being the poor French farming family when really they weren't.
When the Dions were born, I'm sure it was a cultural shock to media people and to big city people that came up here. All right, the There was no running water, but nobody had running water, and we all survived without it. And there was no flush toilets, there was no this and no that, but everybody was happy in the situation they were living. So the Dion family wasn't in any way worse than any of their neighbors or anybody else in the area.
They were put in the position constantly of being made to look foolish by it appearing that they lived in dirty surroundings, that their house was filled with germs and flies and all of this nonsense. I mean, this was all ludicrous. This was all used in an attempt to justify the government action of taking the children away.
Meanwhile, Dr. Defoe's image was taking off. Defoe talked to the media and invited them into his home.
It's difficult to say whether he enjoyed the spotlight. I would say no, I don't think he did. I think he just accommodated people towards the end of his life. The whole thing became too big for everyone, the quintuplet story.
In the time of so much complexity in people's lives and minds and what are we going to do to survive, here you had the simple country doctor who kept them alive at the beginning. So he was made the hero.
And Defoe was clearly in charge of the Dion quintuplets. He hired the nurses and dictated how the quints would be cared for. He moved them across the road into a specially built nursery. He banished the other Dion children from the nursery. Their parents could only visit a half hour every day.
There's a difference between them being placed in a hospital for a matter of a few months and being taken for 9 years.
It was something that was done once the government initially took charge of the quintuplets for the first year. That was extended then to 3 years. That was extended from 3 to 18 years. And that was done solely for financial purposes, for economic purposes, so that the government could have control. The government was the entity that decided on putting them on display.
There was so much public interest in the quints. Everything was scrutinized. And let's face it, if you were in charge of the world's most famous and important children, what if something happened to them?
The split between the two men widened when the Ontario government set up a board of guardians to oversee the quintuplets. Defoe was put on the board, Dion was not. Defoe became the one constant figure in the young girls' lives.
Mr. Dion must have felt very put out that the doctor was given credit almost as the father figure, and he was pushed aside.
It is a fact that the father was the authority, because you often heard children were told, just wait till your father gets home and all that, which is not the way of living today, I imagine, but the father was, yes, the most authoritative person in the family.
Well, it wasn't a simple matter of saying, okay, well, they're healthy now, they're out of danger, we'll return them. They had got themselves in a situation where they weren't sure how to get out of it.
For anyone to look at the story and not blame the government, which we all look to help us, for anyone to look at the story and not blame the government is to basically close your eyes to what really happened, because the government did something that was wrong.
The fact that the world was intensely interested in the quintuplets put the entire situation under a microscope, and it added stress to everyone's life.
The media were every end and turn, everywhere they turned, there were people falling over themselves to ask questions and take photographs.
The farm was overrun by media, by neighbors, people poured in. In fact, there's reports that the incoming media parked in the fields. There's one quote where they staked out the outhouse, figuring Mr. Dion would have to go sometime and they'd get their interview.
All of this public interest eventually turned into cold hard cash. The image of the Quints and Defoe showed up in all kinds of advertising.
I feel that he was enmeshed by the money aspect, the tourism, and he was trapped by the whole thing, from the Hollywood filmmakers to the bed and breakfast people locally to the hunting, shooting and fishing camps who were wanting the Americans up here by the hundreds every summer. The whole thing did become too big. It sucked everyone in. Everyone suffered in the end.
People often will blame Dr. Defoe and put him in opposition to Oliver Dionne, but Defoe couldn't have done this had the government not helped him do it. Defoe was used as a puppet in order for the government to get involved and for the government to make money.
Within a couple of years, the government opened Quintland. The girls were put on display 4 times a day, free of charge. An average of 3,000 people every summer day filed past. The influx of tourists was a boon to Northern Ontario.
This whole thing made the whole area of Lake Nipissing a holiday spot. People could come, they could see the Quints, they could spend a couple of weeks at cottages along the lake and be a real holiday. And it just grew and grew. It started in 1935, but come 1937, Quintland, as it became known, was one of the, it was the third biggest tourist spot in North America after the state of Florida and Niagara Falls.
Mother used to rent her rooms out for tourists, and we weren't the only ones. You know, pretty near every house had rooms to rent because there wasn't any place to stay here.
Well, the young people of that era would just walk up to Quintland and get their pocket money by parking cars, helping clean the toilets, working the gift shops, etc., etc.
Suddenly the government, which had already gotten in the business of taking children away from parents, using in some cases reasonable, in some cases unreasonable reasons to take the children away and put them in this hospital, but once they were taken away, it became fair game. Everyone could do what they wanted.
Oliver Dionne opened a souvenir stand across the road, and once again, he found himself on the wrong side of public sentiment.
He needed money. If anyone's involved in a custody battle against one person, they recognize the amount of money and resources it takes to fight. Think of a custody battle against the entire world, against the government, against a doctor and a staff of people, against all the institutions in the country, against the media, against companies that had money and power because of the endorsements. This is what this man had to fight. But being the strong person that he was, he eventually rose up, he fought them all, and he eventually won.
He was criticized for selling souvenirs, yet every motel and restaurant and gift shop between here and Toronto carried Quint souvenirs.
Defoe was making money too. He went out on the lecture circuit and he made money from his endorsements. And yet, while Oliver Dionne was criticized for making money, no one said a word about Defoe.
If the parents did anything, in fact, they made a couple of tours and they sold autographs, that was, you know, reported without fail. Yet the doctor endorsed products, went on all sorts of talk circuits, but there was never any mention of commercialism made.
Defoe had been put into a position of strength. He was a hero. In the public eye, he was the Quint's father. Whatever he did was right. It had to be right. And the government perpetuated it. Oliver Dionne was in a situation, in many ways, a no-win situation. He was made to look like a fool. He didn't have his children with him, which immediately makes people say, well, obviously the man doesn't have his children with him for certain reasons. They can't take care of them.
The fact that his outward appearance never changed also fed into that myth, because he looked the same. He wasn't suddenly all spiffed up, that, you know, people assumed that he wasn't capitalizing on it.
Eventually, 20th Century Fox did a movie based on the Quintuplets, but the movie focused on the doctor and made Oliver look ridiculous.
And indeed, when the first 20th Century Fox film came out, it was the country doctor. The focus was the doctor. The Quints were only in it for maybe 10 minutes, where you see five little babies in a crib. The portrayal of the father of these five children, who to the world was Oliver Dionne, was absolutely awful. He was made to look like he had little or no IQ. He was just a bumbling fool, simple beyond imagination. No intelligence, no education, just an idiot.
But Defoe's reign wouldn't last much longer. During a trip to New York in late 1938, Defoe took part in a skit called The Doctor of Litters, which publicly ridiculed Oliver Dionne.
He became a celebrity in the first right. I mean, he had a syndicated column. He used to go and do lectures across the United States. He was being interviewed all the time. He became a celebrity. And he got lost in that. He began, I truly believe that he began to think that he was the father of the Quints, that they were alive because of him, and because of, for that reason, he was entitled to them. It's a ludicrous idea.
That was probably his downfall with the public, because it shattered the image. And in fact, a lot of the things that he said when he made his speech just did not live up to the image. The fact that he would much rather be at home, you know, reading, that he was nothing like this media image. He was not a terribly outgoing person. So that, and the fact that, you know, he made this bad decision to go along with this comedy farce, really destroyed the media side of his career.
Defoe's downfall coincided with a change in fortunes for Oliver Dionne. For many years, Dionne had been struggling to regain control of his children. By the early 40s, he was having some success.
Oliver Dionne started fighting the government. He uncovered the money that Defoe had in the bank. It was revealed that Defoe had been had his own endorsements with Colgate and other companies, and that for a man who said he never made any money off the Quints, had a very lucrative bank account from the money from his column and his endorsements. Defoe started to be sick. He had cancer.
For the Quints, it must have been like living through a very long and drawn-out divorce, being pulled between the doctor and the government in that lifestyle, and being pulled by their parents and their family towards that. They were being pushed and pulled too. The nurses going into that situation had to choose sides from day one, you know, whether they knew anything about it or not, and live by that.
And this aspect of English versus French started to come into it, and Oliver Dionne used it effectively. He wanted his children to be educated in French, to be able to speak French.
In early 1942, the Board of Guardians agreed to give Dionne full control over his daughters.
The government really wanted to distance themselves from the whole thing. So they agreed to build this big house so that the family, it was like the end of the story, and here, it all ended up nicely. You see, we're building the family a nice big house, and we're going to reunite the children with their parents, and everybody will live happily ever after.
A year later, Dr. Alan Roy Defoe was dead. He went to his grave without apologizing or without patching up his differences with Oliver Dionne. His will had more than $100,000 in assets, most of it in stocks and bonds. But when all is said and done, it seems the money was a secondary issue.
Suddenly, the kid who had never excelled was the toast of the medical world, and he really enjoyed that. So I think the public attention was more important to him than the money.
In 1943, the Dionne family was reunited in a huge house built by the Ontario government. But by now, the Dionnes were a family of strangers, and the reunion was anything but happy.
Suddenly, they're all dumped in this enormous mansion that Mr. and Mrs. Dionne did not want. That was built by the government for them, because of course the world-famous Quints could not move back into a little farmhouse.
Someone in that government, and right up to the top to Mitchell Hepburn, should have said, if we take children away from their parents and exploit them, we are going to destroy all of them. And that is wrong. But nobody did that.
60 years later, the strange story of the Dionne Quintuplets reads like a modern parable. It shows how the pressures of money and fame can turn ordinary, well-meaning people into bitter enemies. And in the end, the people at the center of such stories are always hurt the most.